story we just read here is of Joshua, the man of God, giving his final address to the children of Israel. Amen. In this conversation that is taking place here, you see, Joshua gives them an overview of their journey from beyond the Euphrates. Amen.
Amen.
In Ur of the Chaldeans. Hallelujah. And Joshua said, your father Abraham and his father Terah, they worshipped idols. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They worshipped idols, meaning they worshipped things that are not the one true God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
But we know that there is only one true God. There are no two gods.
Amen.
There are no three gods.
Amen.
There are no four gods. There are no five gods. But there is only one true God.
Amen.
And this one true God is the only one that must be worshipped.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He's the only one that has to be worshipped.
Amen.
He's the only one that must be worshipped.
Amen.
And all other gods are false gods.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Yes.
So we know that in Genesis, the Lord created the heavens and the earth. Amen. The trees, this place we live here today, this was created by the Lord Jehovah, my God.
Amen.
Amen. The one who gave us ears to hear,
amen,
and eyes to see,
amen,
and the nose to smell. Hallelujah. He is the only true God.
Amen.
There are no other gods. Hindu gods are not gods.
Amen.
The Islamic gods are not gods.
Amen.
The Buddhist gods are not gods.
Amen.
Those are images fashioned to look like earthly things.
Amen.
They are not God.
Amen.
They are false.
Amen.
They are false. And those that adhere to their worship, their end is death. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So we know that there is only one true God. Amen.
Amen.
When he created Adam in the garden, in the garden of Eden, there God met Adam and Eve in the cool of the day. Amen.
Amen.
And in the garden of Eden, men had perfect fellowship with God.
Hallelujah.
For it says, in the image of God, he created them.
Amen.
In the image of God created he them, male and female, he created them. Hallelujah. So they were like God. They bore his image and his glory was in them. His glory was on them. They were wrapped with his glory. They were clothed with his glory. They walked in his glory. They lived in his glory. They fellowshiped in his glory. In perfect harmony with the Father. With God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But one bad day, sin entered through the deception of the snake. Amen. And when men sinned, when Adam listened to Eve, when Eve listened to the serpent, they ate the forbidden fruit. And they died spiritually. And physical death entered into the world. And from that moment on, idol worship entered into the earth that God created. From that moment on, men began to worship things that are not God. There is only one true God. And if there is only one true God, there must be only one true worship. Hallelujah. And we know that our God dwells in heaven. And so the worship that must consume earth must be the only one true heavenly worship. But when men sinned in the garden, sin entered and idol worship also entered. And when idol worship entered, when sin entered, confusion entered, sickness entered, death entered. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And the darkness covered the whole world. So much to such an extent that only one man in his household could be found before God destroyed the entire earth.
Amen.
Before the Lord consumed the whole earth with the floods, worshipped idols all over the world except 8 people.
Amen.
Millions of people inhabited the earth, but only 8 people worshipped correctly.
Hallelujah.
Only 8 people knew the true worship of heaven.
Amen.
But the design of God, when He created Adam and Eve in the garden, His design was that the whole earth will worship Him. Not only one, not only 2 or 8 people, but the entire earth. Because His design was that, that the inhabitants of the earth will be a holy priesthood.
Amen.
Amen. That the whole earth will be a holy priesthood. That in our lives here on earth, in our eating, in our living, that we will worship Him. But when idol worship entered the earth, we know too well that idols have demands. Yeah? Idols have demands. You go to India and you see the demands. You have to eat a certain way. Idol worshippers, the idols give them laws and instructions that the way you eat, you must eat a certain way. The way you wash yourself, you must wash yourself in a certain way. That's why Muslims, they clean themselves with hands, and then they don't do it the way we do, because their idol worship instructs them how to do everything. How to eat, how to go to the toilet, how to drive, how to deceive people, how to dress. Idol worship has put a demand on people. But you see, one idol worship is not enough. That's why you find there are 300 idol gods. One idol god for children, another idol god for passing in school, another idol god for bearing, for fruitful harvest, another idol god for music, another idol god for what? For business, and idol gods for, I don't know, for seducing people. And they have so many idol gods that are powerless. Amen.
Amen.
Powerless. Without power. Powerless. Amen. They have demands. They are demanded. And so when God called Abraham from his household, he worshipped idols. That means Abraham sat under the instruction of idol worship. He ate a certain way. And all the inhabitants of the earth that worship idols, they are instructed by their idol worship how to live. How to live.
Amen.
Their idol worship tells them when to pray, how to pray. Amen. So, sin entered. Idol worship entered. And man was confused. And in this state of confusion, man lost the true worship of heaven. Men didn't know what is the correct way. Because if there is only one true God, there must be only one true worship.
Amen.
But man has not known this one true worship. So they worship idols. Confusion. Working in darkness. Worshipping this one God here. When he does not work, they throw him away. And then they pick another idol. Then if he does not work, they go to the forest. They find a big tree. Very strong tree. They cut it down. And then they carve it into an image that looks like an eagle, or an image that looks like a snake, or an image that looks like a human being. And then they bring it down here. Then they take some of the wood, they put it in the fire, and then they warm themselves at the fire, and they said, now this is my God. He has saved me. He has given me breath. Oh, what confusion.
Amen.
And in the midst of that confusion, this is not how God designed us to be. Worship. That's why God created us. Almighty created us for worship.
Amen.
We must worship someone. We have to worship something. Because when he created Adam and Eve, he put what is called the God-shaped hole in each and every one of us. We cannot go without worship. That's why they always had to find something to worship. But because they lost the direction of heaven, and they did not know the true worship of heaven, they worship idols. Their worship was earthly focused.
Amen.
And so when the Lord intervened and he called Abraham from his father's household, he said, I take you out of idol worship now. Because now I'm beginning to do a new thing. Now I want my original design in the garden to be restored, to prove that plan A is still successful.
Amen.
So the Lord took Abraham that he may now begin what we know as the story of redemption, to restore the heavenly worship in the lives of mankind.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So that we will no longer die. Amen.
Amen.
Because when sin entered, we died.
Amen.
When sin entered, we became sick.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But now he wants to restore the world through worship so that we die no longer. So that we don't get sick anymore. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you still with me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Now, he took Abraham. Are you still with me?
Yes.
Then he says, I take you out of the Ur of the Chaldeans. And then he took him on the journey to the promised land. And then he gave him Isaac. And then to Isaac he gave Jacob and Esau. And then he took Jacob to Egypt. But when they went to Egypt, there was still more idol worship in Egypt. Although he taught Abraham how to worship, and Abraham passed it on to his son, and his son passed it on to his son, when they went to Egypt, there were more than 300 idol gods of Egypt. And when they lived in Egypt, they assimilated the lifestyle of the Egyptians, and they also became idol worshippers there.
Amen.
Tragedy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But his design was that we be separate.
Amen.
That we be separated from sin. From idol worship.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So when he took them to Egypt, and they worshiped idols. That's why Joshua said, when he took them to Egypt, your forefathers worshiped the idol gods in Egypt. But then the Lord remembered them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because the yoke of the Egyptians became so hard.
Amen.
The Egyptian idols have two harsh demands.
Amen.
The Egyptian idols demanded that they build pyramids and big statues, and the Egyptians were now the slaves that had to build the pyramids and the statues, and it was a heavy burden on them.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then they cried out to the Lord, and then the Lord remembered them. Now look at this. When he took them from Egypt, when he sent his servant Moses to Egypt by design, he said, let my son go that he may worship me.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That he may worship me.
Amen.
No, look, he said he will take them to the land of milk and honey.
Amen.
But he was not taking them from Egypt to go and eat honey. He took them out of Egypt to go and worship him.
Amen.
Amen. It was not for milk and honey.
Amen.
It was for worship. Do you hear me?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Maybe you didn't get me. Let me repeat this. When he sent Moses to take them out of Egypt, he said, he will take them to the land flowing with milk and honey. But the design was not to go and eat milk and drink honey. No, the design was, let my son go that he may worship me.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. If they don't worship, they will not eat the milk and the honey.
Amen.
Amen. If they don't worship, the milk and honey is history.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And then Pharaoh refused. He said, I refuse. And he said, you cannot refuse. They have to go and worship.
Amen.
He said, okay, go with the men, leave the children and the animals. He said, no, we cannot.
Amen.
Everyone has to go and worship. everyone.
Amen.
Not only the fathers or the mothers or the children. He said, no, everything. Our cattle, our donkeys, our sheep, our goats, our dogs, everything must go and worship the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That he may war, that they may worship him. And then with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, he struck Egypt so hard. The Egyptians cried and they said, please, let them go.
Amen.
Amen. Saying, now go and worship your God. We don't want go.
Amen.
And then when they left, and then the Lord defeated the Egyptians. Look at this now. In Egypt, they were infested with a lot of idol worship. Lots of idol worship. They were infested with a lot of idol worship. And so the Lord needed to remove Egypt out of them. They have been in Egypt for more than 300 years. So now the Lord needed to remove the Egypt out of them. They were used to Egypt. They were used to the Nile River. They were used to to the pyramids and the cucumbers and the tomatoes and the honey and everything in Egypt. So now he needed to take them through the wilderness of repentance.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So he took them into the desert, into the wilderness of repentance, that they may repent from Egypt.
Amen.
Because Egypt has corrupted their worship. Egypt corrupted the worship of the children of God. So he took them into the wilderness, into the journey through the wilderness of repentance, because he wanted to bring them to a place where they are like this. Every morning they wake up from their tents. The first thing they do is look whether the cloud of God was still standing or moving. Hallelujah. He wanted to bring them from the place where their eyes are not focused on the Nile River, but on the cloud of God. Hallelujah. He wanted to bring them to a place of total surrender and humbleness and repentance. To the place where, look at this, when they wake up in the morning, they poke their head through their tents and they look towards the temple of God and they look whether the cloud of God is still there. If the cloud was standing, then they say, okay, we remain. If the cloud was moving, they say, let us pack up and go. Hallelujah. That is the place where he designed to bring them. But now look at this. Then in the wilderness, he brought them to the Mount of Sinai, the mountain of God. Hallelujah. Where he appeared in his glory, in his tremendous glory, the powerful glory of the Lord, thick darkness and lightning. Hallelujah. To the place where when he spoke to them, they shook. And they turned and they moved back and they said, Moses, please tell the Lord not to speak to us. Let him speak to you, and then he will speak to us through you, and that way we'll be satisfied. Amen. Otherwise, we'll die. Amen. But now look at this. When he took Moses, when they have made that agreement, then he took Moses, the servant of God, to the mountain of the Lord. Mount Sinai. And on that mountain, for 40 days and 40 nights, Moses was in the presence of the Lord. And something very powerful, very historic, happened on that mountain that has changed the face of the earth. Remember, I said, when the worship was lost in the garden, men lost the true worship of heaven. And only a remnant few, very, very few, knew this worship. But the design was that the whole earth be covered by the glory of the Lord as the water covers the sea. So now he had to restore the worship. Now he is restoring the worship that was lost in the garden.
Amen.
Men had not known. Because when you worship, there are certain elements of worship that must be there. Certain elements of worship. They cannot be missing. Amen. Elements of worship. That when you worship the Lord, Jehovah God Almighty, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Adonai, that when you worship Him, there are certain elements that cannot be missing. Cannot. Hallelujah. Amen. So on this mountain, He was now restoring the worship. And then dispensing these powerful elements of worship that cannot be missing. That in your Christianity, in your Christian salvation, that when you observe these elements of worship, hallelujah, that when you observe these elements of worship, then you too will be a royal priesthood and a holy nation. Amen? So he did this. 40 days and 40 nights. Look, he was with the Lord on the mountain, and then he showed him something very powerful. Go to the book of Hebrews chapter 8 verse 5. The book of Hebrews chapter 8 verse 5, he says, Hebrews 8 verse 5, are you there? Hallelujah. Shall I read? Shall I read for you?
Yes.
Hallelujah. If you are there, please say amen.
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 Right, Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5. He said, they serve at a sanctuary that is a copy and shadow of what is in heaven. This is why Moses was warned when he was about to build the tabernacle. He said, see to it that you make everything according to the pattern shown you on the mountain. Amen. Now this one is quoting the book of Exodus 25, verse 40. In Exodus 25, 40, that's where the Lord says, see that you make them according to the pattern shown you on the mountain. So something very tremendous took place on the mountain of Sinai, the mountain of God. Amen. And so on this mountain, he was shown something. But what was he shown? What did the Lord show Moses? Hallelujah. The Lord, listen to this. The Lord did not take Moses to Egypt. Amen?
Amen.
No, wait. What he was shown something, a place. He was shown a place. And then the Lord said, what I showed you here on this mountain, you must replicate on earth. Amen. He said, you must replicate exactly what I showed you on the mountain, you must replicate on earth. But he did not show him Egypt.
Amen.
He did not show him Egypt. You understand? He did not show him Moab. I don't know if you know Moab, but he did not show him Moab. The Lord, when he took Moses on the mountain, he didn't show him the land of Canaan. The Lord did not show him the land of the Amorites, or the land of the Perizzites, or the land of the Hittites, or the land of the Jebusites, or the land of the Perizzites, or the land of the Philistines, or the land of the Canaanites, or the Amorites, or the Edomites. No, he did not show them the Hivites. The Lord did not take Moses to the temple of the Hivites. This is very important. Because he designed that we be separate. Hallelujah. He took him not to Egypt, not to Moab. Meaning, what he was going to do from that moment onwards was not Egyptian. Meaning, what the Lord told him to replicate in the wilderness was not Moabite. It was not a Moabite lifestyle. In other words, he did not take him to Namibia, so it is not a Namibian lifestyle that he told him to replicate. Or an American lifestyle.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is very important. Make no mistake. Hallelujah. What he showed him on the mountain was not earthly. You understand? Because in the book of Corinthians, Paul said, what is earthly is what? Is perishable. Is temporary. Dies. Vanishes. What is of the earth? What is of the earth? Dies. Has a life shelf that expires. Hallelujah. So if the Lord did not show Moses Egypt or earthly things, then that means whatever he was asked to replicate was not perishable. Amen. Are you with me? So that means what the Lord showed Moses was not perishable. It was not prone to death and corruption. What did he show him there? Hebrews 5:8-5 says, it was heavenly things. Amen. He showed him, in fact, the Lord took Moses and took him to heaven itself. And whatever he saw was heavenly.
Amen.
And Paul said, what is heavenly, what is unseen, is eternal. Has no shelf life, does not expire, does not die, is not corruptible, is not mortal, is not, it does not perish. Hallelujah. So he was given an eternal heavenly worship to replicate on earth.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
What the Lord gave Moses on the mountain was the heavenly worship that has been missing from the earth for a very, very long time. For a long time. So he was now restoring the perfectly heavenly eternal worship that has no end. That has no end. That has no end.
Amen.
Amen. That has no end. That must never end. That today, 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 as we speak, the worship he showed him on the mountain continues until now. Amen. Until right now, as we speak, now it's 11:30, 11:28. The worship he showed him on the mountain is still happening right now.
Amen.
Amen. So the conversation and the instruction in this worship was that they be a holy priesthood. So he gave them the temple, a very important element of worship. So amongst, so again, now opening up the elements of worship that he gave them to observe, that he gave us to observe, hallelujah, that cannot be missing in our Christian salvation, hallelujah, in our worshiping of the Lord. These elements of worship cannot be missing, cannot. If you remove them, then you wind up worshiping another. Amen. The temple of worship, the tabernacle, that is one of them. He gave them the tabernacle of God, the place where God dwells, his holy habitation. And then he gave them the ark of God's covenant, the covenant, the agreement, the instruction of God. Hallelujah. And he gave them the garments of worship. Hallelujah. The holy garments of worship that cannot be missing. Cannot. Cannot be missing. Without the garment, no worship. If the garment is stained, no worship. Hallelujah. Look at this. So he gave them the elements of worship, including the garment of the holy priesthood. The holy priesthood. And also the high priesthood. Amen. He gave them the holy priesthood and the holy high priesthood. And he gave them the utensils that were used in the tabernacle of God. And then he gave them the sacrifice of God that touches the heart of God. Amen. The sacrifice of God that cannot be missing. Cannot. If you remove the sacrifice, there is no worship. Amen. There is no worship. Hallelujah. He gave them the house of the Lord. He gave them the altar of sacrifice that cannot be missing. If there is no altar of sacrifice, the sacrifice cannot be offered.
Hallelujah.
And then there is no worship.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So he gave them this powerful worship. And it was like this. For the first time in the history of the earth.
Amen.
Since the fall. Yeah? Because in the garden, what he gave them now in Exodus 25, in the garden, it was all here. It was here.
Hallelujah.
And the ark of God's covenant was here.
Amen.
And the temple, the habitation of God was here. When they sinned, it left.
Amen.
It left and darkness consumed the earth. Now he was restoring that worship, so he had to bring it back. And he gave it to them to observe. But there was a problem. Because in their worshiping Jehovah, in their Christian salvation, they became too familiar with their worship.
Amen.
Too familiar. Oh, today pastor is preaching. I know he's going to preach about give your life to Jesus. I think I can even finish his whole sermon. I think pastor has nothing new. Hey, tragedy.
Amen.
So in their worshiping of Jehovah, they became too familiar with the worship. They became too familiar with the pastor. They became too familiar with the sacrifice of God. They lost the fear of God. And at the root of this problem was what we call sinful flesh. Sinful flesh. The flesh that leads to immorality. The flesh that leads to stealing and lying. There was sinful flesh ruining the worship of Jesus.
Amen.
Sinful flesh. Again and again telling them to idol worship. That's why you see there is a huge controversy in the scriptures there. Now again he saves them, but then they end up going back to idol worship. And then he gives them all together into the hands of the idol worshippers. And then he comes back, he remembers them, he brings them back, he restores the worship, and then again they sin. And then he gives them again into the hands of the idol worshippers. And then again he brings them back. So sinful flesh was at the root of this problem. They kept backsliding and coming back and backsliding and coming back and say, how long will you backslide? Because this worship is not today we worship and then next time again. It's not Sunday we worship, Monday we keep quiet. Until the next Sunday, then we worship again. No, it is an eternal worship. You cannot take a break. Hallelujah. In heaven, they don't take a break. No, read it. He says, then they go down, they bow down, they take off their crowns, and then they prostrate themselves on the floor, and they worship him, then they sit back again, and then they go back, and then they continually say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, day and night without getting tired.
Amen.
Amen. But, now, while they are doing that in heaven, on earth, they are still playing around with idol worship in their hearts. And he got so fed up with them to the extent that he said, oh, how I wish that someone will go down there and shut the door.
Hallelujah.
Say, put off your useless fires. Your sacrifice is ruined. Because when they went to their capital post, to their crowds, yeah, to take the offering, to take the sacrifice of the Lord, because he said the tenth animal is a sacrifice. So when they went there, then the tenth one is the one that produced milk. The tenth one is the fat one, the one that gives good breed. The tenth one is the male that is strong and healthy and produce good offspring. They said, no, we cannot give you to the Lord. They said, no, there is one that is sick. Let us bring the sick one and replace it with a healthy one.
Yeah.
Surely the Lord will accept as long as the sacrifice. He said, I refuse.
Amen.
The Lord said, I refuse. You cannot be too familiar with my worship and then rob me. Eh? Then rob him of his worship. Like that. Look, they took an animal that was healthy, that was supposed to go for the Lord. Then they took a sinful, a sick, broken, lean, skinny animal that is sick to give to the Lord. A sick animal. And when they give the sick animal to the Lord, that showed how sick their worship was before the Lord.
Amen.
Broken worship. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And he was fed up with their sick worship. He said, look, can you go to your president and give him the sick animal? Really? Can you invite the president of your country and say, we have a party, a birthday party, we are going to get the animal with anthrax. We are going to get the animal with smallpox or whatever diseases affect animals. Eh? Foot and mouth disease. Are you going to give that to President Hage?
No.
No. Now why will you give it to the Lord? Who is big? Who's bigger?
Amen.
Who's more powerful?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so, sinful flesh intervened. And because of this sinful flesh, now the Lord, so the worship was not very perfect. He gave them the elements of worship. Very powerful. But sinful flesh ruined the worship. So, he designed that at one point he was going finally to defeat sinful flesh so that in our Christian salvation, our worship will be made perfect.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Do you see what's happening here? It was not for milk and honey. When they came to the land that flows with milk and honey, they became so fat. He said to them, Jeshurun, he talks about Israel, the Jeshurun is thick and fat and is kicking. So fat from the milk and honey. And now they forgot their God. The design was not for them to go there and become fat with milk and honey. It was for worship. He brought them to the land of milk and honey to worship him. Not to be sleek and fat and kick and reject the Lord. Hallelujah. It was for worship. Such that if they don't worship, then he will judge them. He will kill them. He will give them into the hands of their enemies. Was not for them to just eat, no, but to worship. The design was worship, that they may worship him all the days of their lives. But there was that problem of sinful flesh. But then a time came when finally sinful flesh met the Lord. And it says in the book of Romans chapter 8, he says, condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, those who walk according not to the flesh but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh.
Hallelujah.
That the righteousness of the law, in other words, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Amen. So, he designed that we worship him perfectly in holiness and righteousness. When he gave them the law, the instruction of worship in Exodus, the purpose was for them to be holy and righteous. But because of sinful flesh, because of sinful flesh, they had to offer the sacrifice over and over and over again. Because of sinful flesh, their high priest died. Because of sinful flesh, they were too familiar with the worship. Because of sinful flesh, they rejected the Lord. Because of sinful flesh, they were backsliding now, and then they come back. And then they backslid, and then they came back. And then they backslid. He says, no, we must draw a line now. No more backslide, come back, backslide. The worship must be perfect. Hallelujah. So, what was needed now was not to change the elements of worship. No. It was because the tabernacle he made them build here on earth was the representation of the heavenly one. So now he designed that he brings the tabernacle of heaven itself down. Hallelujah. So instead of telling them to build another tabernacle to represent the one that is in heaven, now he decided to bring the heavenly one here. Now, instead of giving them a high priest who will die again and who will need to offer sacrifice for his own sin again and again, now he designed that he gives them a high priest who will not die. A high priest with no sin.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now he's really perfecting the worship in their lives.
Amen.
He gives them a high priest that is holy and will never die. Then he gives them the sacrifice. A sacrifice that has maximum power.
Amen.
Amen. Because when he gave them the sacrifice in the wilderness, they had to offer one today, another one tomorrow, another one the next day, and then another one next month. No, he says, no, now I must give them a sacrifice that has, whose blood has maximum power, not only to take away sin, but also to heal them.
Amen.
And convert them.
Hallelujah.
From mortality to immortality.
Amen.
From perishability to imperishability.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. From corruption to incorruption.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So now now he's really perfecting the worship he gave them in the wilderness.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So he says that the righteous requirement of the Lord might be fully met in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So what he did is, he sent his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, so that he takes sin one-on-one, and then he takes sin a huge punch, and then Satan, he fought him so heavy, he gave him a heavy blow. And then he gave Satan a very heavy blow, and took the authority from him. The authority of sin and death. Then he took it. And then, when he won on the cross, wait, when he came to do this big fight on the cross to deliver the sons of God, that they may worship him correctly, he came. Then he met a woman at the well. And he said, "Woman, give me water." And he says, "You are a Jew, I'm a Samaritan. How can you ask me for water?" He says, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that says to you, 'Give me water,' you would have asked him and he will give you living water." And he says, "Sir, the well is deep. The well is deep. Are you greater than our father Abraham, Jacob, who dug the hole himself and then took the water and gave us and his animals? And then he said to the woman, the woman said to him, 'You Jews,'" he says to him, "You Jews worship," "you Jews say that we should worship not on this mountain here, but in Jerusalem." But he says, no, the time is coming.
Hallelujah.
A time is coming when the true worshippers will worship the Father in truth and in spirit. Hallelujah. The perfect worship he desires. At another time, when he spoke to them in a very heated conversation, they said to him, "What sign will you show us so that we'll believe you?" He said, "Just tear down this temple, and then I'll build it up in 3 days. And then they said, "This temple has taken a long time to build. Will you build it in 3 days?" They didn't know that the one who was speaking to them was the tabernacle of God.
Amen.
Was the habitation of God itself.
Hallelujah.
In the book of Hebrews there, it says, chapter 3, it says, was it chapter 1? It says, in the book of chapter 1, the book of Hebrews, it says, "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in many ways," various ways. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 2. "But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things. And through him also, he made the universe." Do you mind? The strings. Thank you. He says, "But in this last day, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to the earth. So when the Son came, he came as the tabernacle of God." Look at the mystery now. Here is the mystery. He came not only as the tabernacle, but he came as the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of men. When he came as the tabernacle, as the temple, and as the sacrifice, he also came as the high priest. When he came as the high priest, he also came now. He came now with the powerful, glorious garments. Because in the book of Mark chapter 9, it says, when they looked at him, he was so transfigured.
Amen.
So the glorious garments of worship, he was clothed in them. And then the design was this, that when he died on the cross, he took his perfect blood. His perfect blood. And then he went now back to heaven, to the same tabernacle that he told Moses to return. on the horns of the altar and at the base of the altar on those hot coals of heaven. And he atoned for our sin.
Amen.
And this maximum powerful blood, this blood with maximum power, became now the sacrifice for all time.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So until today, that sacrifice, the power of that sacrifice continues.
Amen.
Until today, the blood that was offered on the cross is effective today.
Amen.
But now look at this. Because the element of worship cannot be missing. The sacrifice must remain. It was not offered 2,000 years ago, and then it remains in 2,000 years ago. No. The blood was offered 2,000 years ago, and it continues effective until today, till eternity.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And then, because he is the high priest, so he does not die. So until today, he is still the high priest.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He is still the high priest until today, today as we speak. Hallelujah. Until today. Now, the sacrifice, the altar of sacrifice also remains until today in heaven. Today. Hallelujah. But now, because we, as the church of Christ, as the children of God, we must have an encounter with the temple of God. Now, instead of us going to a structure made with human hands, he said no. Because now I want the worship to be perfect. I want the worship to be perfect. Then he said this. He said, to as many as received him, to them he gave power to be called children of God. And then he said, when we receive him, then he replicates himself in us.
Yes, hallelujah.
So now the temple of God is this one here.
Amen.
It's that one there.
Yes,
it is this one here. So the